Welcome to episode number 5 with Australian celebrity Dr. Brad McKay from Embarrassing Bodies Down Under. Welcome to Believe. I'm Sam Barry. I'm an internet entrepreneur and I'm here to help you discover what it takes to believe in yourself. You're listening to this show today because your time has come. People who were no smarter than you made everything around you that you call life. You were born with a remarkable dream. You were born to make an impact, but there was one thing stopping you: belief. Each week, we share a powerful message or guest from around the world. It's an honor having you here today. It's time to believe. Welcome to Believe. I'm your host, Sam Barry, and on today's episode, we have celebrity Dr. Brad McKay on the show. And we're going to talk about his life and how he got into medical school at just age 16 and became a fully practicing doctor at the age of 21. Remember, this show is about getting you to believe in yourself, to know that you can achieve anything that it is you want to achieve in life. Thanks for tuning in today. You're going to be learning a lot from Dr. Brad. And now here is Brad McKay. Welcome back, everybody. I have Dr. Brad McKay from Embarrassing Bodies Down Under on the show. Dr. Brad, welcome to the show.
You're very welcome. Thanks for having me on.
Dr. Brad McKay is a celebrity doctor from Embarrassing Bodies Down Under. He entered medical school at age 16 and became a doctor at 21. How on earth did you do that?
It's such a long time ago now. I grew up in New Zealand, so I was brought up in a small town just outside of Wellington. Mm-hmm. And went to a very small school over there. And they sort of had a few people that were in the school. We had a school of about 37 people. Mm-hmm. And they decided that the pump up about 4 people that were in the middle level up to the top level. So I skipped a year of school there, and then I moved over from Wellington area over to Melbourne when I was about 14. Okay. And then got into the year 11, the second to last year of school. Yeah. When I was 14, just turning 15, and then did my year 12, my last year of school, when I was 16, and then got accepted into medicine when I was sort of 16, about to turn 17. So I was younger than most of the people in my university class and cutting up dead bodies when I'm 17 and learning lots about human anatomy and sex and drugs and rock and roll. So that's how I got into medicine at that young age.
So you were 16 when you actually entered university. Could we talk about your experience being in university at 16 years old?
Well, I had to fight a little bit and study a lot. And I think one of the reservations before I was accepted was whether I would be able to keep up with everybody else and whether my maturity level was up to everybody else's standard. Mm. I proved myself in the interview and proved myself in life and through the university course. Mm-hmm. And made my way through. But it's a lot of hard work and working in McDonald's for a while and Sizzler, that lovely restaurant. Worked in Blockbuster Video for a long while as well, just to make my way through. It was really annoying in the first year because I couldn't drive, so I had to get a lift with everybody else or catch the bus, and everybody else is going out partying and I'm just sort of going home and studying or having a very quiet weekend. So that was probably good for my education at that time.
Were you respected as a young doctor?
Yeah, I think I was sort of, in my early 20s when I was a fully fledged doctor and I was going around the ward and looking after patients. And quite often I'd be going to do a procedure, like putting a drip into somebody's arm, and they would sort of roll their eyes at me and say, "When's the real doctor coming?" and on ward rounds, a lot of people just thought that I was the young medical student or that the medical student was actually the doctor. So it was more the patients shock and surprise rather than my peers, because I'd gone a lot of the time just through university and they were very used to seeing me. I'd had my face around the hospital for a long time, so that wasn't an issue. Mm-hmm. But it was, yeah, more the people who didn't have me in their ideal view of being a doctor.
What did you learn being a young doctor?
I think I learned a lot of confidence from that, because I just needed to do my job and get through everything. So with everybody questioning my age, I just got on with it and said, well, this is how it is and this is what we're doing and we've got to do this. And I was just very professional, very polite, very courteous. And I think that won over the hearts of many people. Mm-hmm. And I gained a lot of trust really quickly from just being matter of fact and being really, approachable.
What inspired you to become a celebrity doctor?
I suppose, like there's multiple things. I suppose the biggest event that really happened through my life that was inspirational was really early on. When I was going through my final 2 years of school, when I was like 14, 15, 16, I started getting a lot of pain in my back, in my lower back. And I started seeing a GP at that time, my family doctor, and I was just told, oh, yeah, you've got the same thing that I've got. And he was about in his mid-50s, and I was there going, oh, I'm sort of 15. Maybe it's not the same thing. Sent me off to see physios, and then ended up sending me to an osteopath, and then they were doing heat therapy on my back, and I had 2 CT scans on my lumbar spine, and the pain was getting a lot worse, and I wasn't sleeping. I was waking up in the middle of the night with low back pain. Mm-hmm. Finally, the osteopath that I was diligently seeing was away one day, and he had an offsider that was working for him that day, and he just took one look at me and said, I'm not sure I can fix you. I think you need to have a bone scan done, a nuclear medicine scan. And so they sent me off within a couple of days, and then found that I had a bone tumor that was growing in the base of my spine.
Wow.
About the size of a walnut. So it had just been slowly growing for a couple of years, was causing a lot of pain, a lot of discomfort. I couldn't participate in sport towards the end of year 12. I was trying to sit my exams without being able to sleep, and from sort of like having to move around every 5 minutes in my study chair. I got accepted into medicine, and then having my interviews while I was having this horrible diagnosis, and then had an operation to remove the tumor. Yep. Thankfully, it wasn't cancerous, so they got everything out. I was still recovering and learning how to walk again after being in agonizing pain after the operation, and sort of staggered into my lecture theatre. Just a couple of weeks after having the operation done. So from that early time, it was just a real eye-opener for what it's like to be a patient and for what it's like to be in agony, what it's like to be struggling with chronic pain or a chronic medical condition. And I think that's given me a lot of compassion over time for other people. And people come into the clinic to see me in general practice, and I put in the time, and I look at what I can do and how I can help people out, and try to go to that nth degree. I think it's been very inspirational, like having a misdiagnosis for a couple of years and not getting the answers that I was wanting, and not being able to progress in life. So I think that's probably the most profound time that I've had, and probably the most inspiring moment in my career.
Should we really do what we're passionate about?
I think if people are looking at helping other people, it's. I think that there's still a lot of value in doing something that you're really passionate about. One of my friends is really passionate about Oscar's Law, advocating for the rights of animals. And so, that's where she finds her passion, and that's where she's racing around and going to all the events. I'm passionate about people, so I don't quite get it, but I really appreciate what she does. I think it's finding what your niche area is and what really drives you. I think if you're trying to sort of come up with something to help other people, you may flounder if you're not inspired to do it. But it's also getting out there and trying different things and seeing what is valuable for you and what you get a real rise out of. One of my other friends has been serving soup at one of the soup kitchens in Melbourne for many, many years. And he, never dreamed that he'd be doing it, but just started doing it and loved it. So okay. I think experimenting and just getting out there and seeing what you like. If you don't like it, move on to the next thing. And yeah, just really find where your niche area is.
Are you an introvert or an extrovert?
Well, I'm sort of more of an introverted person than an extroverted one. I find that I gain a lot more energy from sitting at home and reading a book or watching a movie, and that's where I really feel comfortable, and that's where I regain my energy, whereas other people are like really out there and really gain their energy from talking to other people. So I am naturally a little bit more inclined to sit back, but I put myself out there and put myself out into party situations, and I remember one time I started doing improvisational theatre because I was scared of being on stage and needing to just come up with a whole lot of stuff on the spot and making up stories, and I made a point of getting out there and doing what I needed to do, and did a lot of improvisational theatre classes, and then that helped me a lot more with when I came into doing the media stuff as well. It was sort of by chance, it was exactly the right thing that I needed to do.
So how did you become a host on Embarrassing Bodies Down Under?
It was putting myself out there. So I was just working at a general practice that was down the road from Channel 10. And they were looking for doctors to speak on the project on one of the news shows in the evening. And so I, a lot of the other doctors at work just didn't want to have a bar of it. They weren't interested at all in being on the screen. And I just put my hand up and said, yeah, for sure, that'd be awesome. So I just started speaking a little bit on the new show, did it a few times, and then out of the blue got an email asking if I wanted to audition for Embarrassing Bodies, the Aussie version. And I thought I was being punked at the time. Because Embarrassing Bodies from the UK was one of my favourite shows. It was my favourite medical show because it was fun, it was cheeky, and it got a lot of good, solid health messages out there to the public. So when I was asked to be a presenter or to try out to be a presenter on my favourite show, it was like, what? Seriously? So I ended up Googling the lady that was sending me the emails and found out that she was a real deal. And auditioned over Skype, and then she came down from Sydney and interviewed me at my clinic in Melbourne. And then within a week I sort of had the role. And then it was fun starting off day one going, oh my god, I'm doing my own TV show, and I'm seeing patients in the back of a truck in Parramatta in Sydney. So it was a little bit surreal, and got me on board on the media bandwagon very, very quickly. And there's a lot of doubt that comes into your mind about whether you can do it or not. If you're doing a new job and you're so used to doing general practice and you're so used to seeing patients without cameras around, it's a bit of a different vibe when you're seeing people and you've got like a sound guy and a cameraman and your producer sort of all sitting in the room with you as you're having this intimate discussion with your patients.
What have been some of your biggest failures?
A very interesting question. I think not many people like to talk about their own failures.
No.
I think my biggest failure that I laugh at now, because I find it quite funny, but at the time I was mortified, was when I was still a junior doctor, so still in my early 20s, and I was wondering what I wanted to do. I wondered if I wanted to do psychiatry or if I wanted to do general practice or if I wanted to be a pediatrician. And so looking at a few different options. And so I had an interview at the Royal Children's Hospital to be a resident there looking after the kids. And so I've rocked up to the interview, and it's in Melbourne, and it's pelting down with rain outside, and didn't have an umbrella with me, just had a jacket. Running late, pulled into the car park, running up there. I was trying to get there up there in time for the interview, all hot and bothered and sweaty and covered in rain, and then got there disheveled. And then they just said, oh, yep, just have a seat and they'll be with you soon. And in the waiting room, there were all these pamphlets there about all of the different jobs that you could apply for and what jobs you could do as a resident. So I picked up all these pamphlets and sat down in the seat and was reading these pamphlets and trying to calm down. And gradually, like, other people started turning up in this room for the interviews after me. Mm. And they're all turning up in their, like, suits and amazing smart business dresses and looking about 10 years older than me, all of them. And mm. I just tried to make sort of awkward conversation and said, oh, so what have you been doing? What's been your last job? They're like, oh, yes, I've been over in Kenya looking after African children with HIV and AIDS. Mm. And I'm there going, oh, yeah, I'm just finishing up my internship at like at my local hospital in Melbourne. Yeah, haven't been over to Africa at all. And I felt very out of it. Mm. I was, knowing that the caliber of applicant was quite high, slightly more experience than I had, maybe a decade or 15 years more experience than what I had. And, got called into the interview. And I thought there might be one or two people, but I walked into the interview and there's like five or six people sitting behind this long table. Mm. And as I walked through the door, I had my wet jacket in one hand and all these pamphlets in the other. And I tripped through the doorway as I walked into the room. The pamphlets flew everywhere like confetti. I fell flat on my face onto my wet jacket. And rolled around on the floor, trying to pick up all these pamphlets, and then just like crumpled into the seat in front of these people that were all staring at me and glaring at me. And then just the interview went downhill from there. So I sort of left going, well, maybe I won't be a pediatrician. And maybe I'll leave it for a few more years and try not to bite off a little bit more than what I can chew. So it was a learning event, and totally the wrong thing. I totally wasn't prepared for the interview. I totally wasn't at the right stage of my career to be applying for it. Totally mortified, totally embarrassed. But I learnt to pick myself up off the floor and pick up all of my pamphlets from the confetti everywhere, and hold my head up high when I walked out of the interview, and kept on doing a good job with what I was doing.
So what was your biggest takeaway from that failure?
I think that what I learned in that area was that failure is more likely to happen if you're not prepared for the situation that you're going into. And so the failure that I experienced was a sign that I hadn't had enough experience as a doctor. I wasn't as determined to be a pediatrician as what I really thought that I was. The failure just helped me to learn that, you need to be really well prepared for what you're doing, and you really need to put in a lot of determination into it. If you do fail, then, maybe something wasn't going right, more effort needs to be put in, more study needs to be done, or you're just unlucky. Mm. To be the most prepared that you can be for that situation.
A quick shout out to our sponsors over at Shopify. If you're thinking about opening up an online business, the best way to do it is through Shopify. They have easy to use templates and they'll get you up and running within minutes. Go to my website, sambarry.com, and click on the Shopify link. Then send me an email and tell me that you've used my link, and I'll send you a couple of free ebooks showing you how to set up your own online dropshipping business. Do you think luck played a part in your career?
Yeah, I was reading an article last week about getting into medical school, and the universities were saying, like, I think it's Queensland University, one of the head guys there was saying that that they have like about 1,000 people that are capable of becoming amazing doctors for 200 places. So it really comes down to luck of the draw, how you do on your examination date, how you do on your at your university, your interview time, I should say. There's a lot that goes towards luck, and you may be fully qualified, you may have all the experience, but you may not get the right break. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of, very much key in the media world that I've been involved with as well, that you could have the best idea for the show, but if there's no funding for it, if it's not in vogue at the moment, then you won't get it. You won't get the funding for it.
Have you been getting a lot of respect from colleagues and from people within the industry?
I think it's sort of growing over time. I'm being a little bit more well-known in the social media world. I've made a lot of connections with doctors that are also in social media. I've started speaking at social media events for health practitioners and trying to get people out there. So there's a fair bit of respect from people that I see and that I meet on social media. I think the show Embarrassing Bodies Down Under was probably criticized the most from other colleagues, saying, oh, this is terrible television, and how dare they make light of these patients' conditions. I'm like, well, we're not making light of it. We're trying to make people aware of it.
This show's about believing in yourself. Have you always had a strong belief in yourself, like, I can do anything, I can become anybody?
No, I'm very self-deprecating. I don't think that at all. I think that there are a lot of restrictions. I think that there are a lot of areas that I can go into, and there are a lot of interest areas that I can go into. But yeah, I don't believe that I could be anyone that I believe I can be. I think that, I have to have all of the wind heading in the right direction and maybe born into the right family. So I don't believe in that. I believe that I can do the best job that I can do, and I believe that I can put a lot of effort into things, and I believe that I can enjoy life along the way, and I need to be enjoying where I'm at and what I'm doing and be passionate about where I'm at in life. But yeah, I'm very self-deprecating in that regard. So that may be the wrong question for me. But yeah, I think there are a lot of listeners that are in the same situation as me, that are just dedicated to what they think is right and in what they want to accomplish. They may not feel that they're the best person in the world, and I think that you have to have a lot of confidence to be in that position. And I think even the people that do feel that confident probably have a bit of self-doubt in the back of their mind as well. But it's about being rational and about being logical and saying, well, this is my utmost. I'd love to have my own show and be on TV every day and see patients like on 2 days a week, and yeah, getting things going and having my utmost life. I'd love to have a very expensive house and a beautiful car. But I'm happy in my rental apartment and having food on the plate and having a nice walk around the block when I need to.
Well, there you go. If there is a Hollywood producer listening to this podcast right now, Dr. Brad McKay is available.
Oh, totally.
to head off to Los Angeles.
Perfect.
What's the proudest moment in your career?
The proudest moment. That's tough. I think there is something about getting your degree. I think dressing up in a fancy hat and a cloak is quite a special moment. And I think it's very symbolic about what you've accomplished. I felt very achieved when I was sitting in the lecture theatre at the university and having my degree handed over to me. And I think that there's a certain... said in something about having that piece of paper and knowing that you've been working for such a long time to get that accomplishment. I worked for a longer time and studied for a very long while with general practice as well. But yeah, I didn't go to the fellowship presentation of my award. It was sort of just posted to you. So it didn't have the same gravitas as what your medical degree does. So I think that's sort of like a proud moment. It's weird. I suppose having a piece of paper seems really, really bizarre, but it's still got a lot of symbolism in it.
Do you believe that by adding value to others, you're adding value to your own life?
Very interesting. Adding value. I think that's the key crux. What does that mean? What does it mean in your opinion with adding value?
Well, in my opinion, that just means being the best that you can, give to others. If you have knowledge, share that knowledge. Do everything that you can to impart onto other people. And just give them everything that you can. If you can serve them and help, help cure them, as you know, think, you're adding value.
Yeah, I think from that perspective, from a business perspective and also a doctor's perspective, it's a very intriguing question. For me, adding value to people, I I sort of see that as paying people respect, and whoever comes into my clinic, whoever I see on the street, whoever I'm working with in media as well, I'm very careful of showing them a lot of respect and holding them in esteemed value. And also my ability to advocate for people's health, if it's ringing up a specialist and asking and pleading for an appointment with them, if it's, like trying to organize a referral at the hospital, if it's communicating with other doctors so my patient's health can improve as a consequence of that, I believe that that's adding value to the patient and the people that I'm looking after and optimizing their health as well. So yeah, I certainly believe that that's where I get a bit of a kick out of things as well. I think that I feel that I'm achieving things if others are feeling better, if they're less in pain, if they're able to walk down the street rather than just sit in their house, if they're not dying from a horrible disease. That's sort of I see my job as sort of adding value and feeding into their lives and helping them to be the best that they can be. Yeah, so I feel that I get a lot of value from that as well, and that's where I get the most excited.
If you were to have your own TV show, what would it be called?
Oh, very good, very good. Other than the Brad show, I would need to think of something else. I haven't thought of a show name specifically, but yeah, I'd love to have a show that was advocating for people's health. I'd love to be educating the public, and helping people to realize that what they've got going on may not be right and might need to get checked out. Early diagnosis would probably be a good name.
Not like Dr. Brad or the Dr. Brad McKay show.
Well, that would be ultimate, but I'm very self-deprecating, so I need to go down a few rungs from that.
I'm going to now ask you some rapid-fire questions. What's one of your favorite quotes?
The quote that I live by is the quote, "Take your own pulse." "Take your own pulse" is from a book called The House of God, which is written by Samuel Shem. And it's sort of like the Bible for medical students going through medical school. And it's written a very tongue-in-cheek experience of an intern working in hospital. And he has a whole set of rules in the hospital to live by. And one of the rules is the first rule at a cardiac arrest is to take your own pulse. And the whole principle of that is that if you're racing around doing something else in the hospital, suddenly the code blue alert goes on, you have to race to somebody who's lying dead in front of you without a heartbeat. The first thing for you to do is to take your own pulse, slow down, make sure that you're okay, make sure that everybody else around you is okay, and then you might be useful for the patient. So I think that you can certainly race into a situation, especially in business. You can jump through that door and have an interview with a pediatric hospital. And if you don't take your own pulse and if you don't slow down first, then you'll be useless. So I think that's something that I certainly live by, and it's very important to slow down and take note about where you're at. And make sure that your health is okay so you can actually improve the health of other people.
What do you think is holding back most people from achieving greatness in their lives?
I think fear. I think a lot of people are afraid to put themselves out there. They're afraid of embarrassment, one of my specialty areas. They're afraid of, making a leap and being passionate about what they want to achieve. So that's fear, and I think fear then leads into procrastination as well. So often people will just put off what they don't feel quite comfortable doing, and they'll make up excuses for it. But I think the driving force of that is fear.
What's the change that you'd like to be in the world?
The change that I'd like to be in the world. I think, I would love to be a change of, it's hard to word my answer. I think if I can get people to advocate for themselves and for their own health. That's the change that I'd like to do. I think by leading by example and being open and genuine and honest, and yeah, having people see me in that role and being an honest, genuine guy who's trying to do the best in life and trying to get the best outcomes for the people that I work with and the people who are my patients. If I can live by example, then that would be an amazing change. And if people could then follow that example and be that change as well, then I think I've done a good job.
What does success mean to you?
Success means to me to have a roof over your head and food on the table. If you've got those two things, you're not doing too badly.
What's one book that has inspired your life as a celebrity doctor?
The House of God by Samuel Shem that I mentioned before. And that's probably been the most inspiring book. What were you going to say?
We'll definitely have that in the show notes.
That book would be one of the most inspiring things for me. The plain upfront language that was used to describe things that were going on in the hospital. And I think the honesty that's in that book and the comedy was able to lighten up my time as a young doctor and as a medical student and enable me to realize that other people were going through the same thing and that I wasn't the only one who was having these experiences. So I think that identification through the book was really, really helpful to get me through the really tough times.
So what is the House of God about?
The House of God is basically a year in the life of an intern, so a young doctor starting off working in the public hospital system. A very interesting time of them learning out, learning what their job is, where they're wanting to progress to in the future, their dating lives, the patients that they come across, and all of the lessons that they learn, as well as the ridicule that's given to them by their senior colleagues, all of which is relevant to young doctors of today.
Are there any apps or resources that you use?
One of the ones that I really recommend is to most of my patients and lots of friends as well is an app that's done by a guy called Andrew Johnson, and he is a psychologist who lives over in Scotland, and he's got a lot of brilliant apps, and they're basically helping you to take your own pulse, helping people to slow down. So it's evidence-based medicine, looking at meditation and about relaxation. So he's got one that's called Deep Sleep, and he's got one called Procrastination and another one called Success. I used to use it a lot when I was going through a more stressful period of life, and plugging in my headphones, turning on this app, and then his lovely Scottish voice with these dulcet tones would put me to sleep. I think it's a really well put together app, and really looks at a variety of different ways of muscle relaxation strategies to help you to relax and to switch off. And I think a lot of people that are entrepreneurs or that are in business have a lot of stress, and it's really hard to switch off and switch off that brain, that computer that keeps on working all the time, coming up with different ideas. So I find that it's something natural that you can use, and it's simple to use, it's cheap as well, and much better than getting addicted to sleeping tablets as well, which a lot of people do go into over time. I think he's got a brilliant presentation of that app, and I highly recommend it.
Do you meditate? And if you do, how does that benefit you?
I often do meditate to Andrew Johnson, which was fine until I got a patient who spoke with the same Scottish accent. And so every time he came into the room, I would start to fall asleep. And I had to pinch my leg to sort of keep awake. And so, yeah, that's one of the problems with his app, is that you'll feel very relaxed every time you hear a Scottish man talk.
Okay. All right. If you were starting out all over again, if you're a teenager, what would you do differently? What steps would you take?
I would probably be more pushy about getting my bone tumor diagnosed at an earlier stage, I would have advocated for my health a little bit more aggressively rather than relying on the doctors at the time to tell me what to do. I think, my knowledge of medicine and about my body has changed over time. So if I was going back with that knowledge, I would have been able to help diagnose myself at a much earlier level, and that would have caused a lot less suffering over my life. So that would be one thing that I'd consider redoing again.
What are your parting words of wisdom, and how can we reach out to you?
I would advise for people, I say this all the time, be nice to people, be nice to other people. It doesn't mean that you have to agree with them all the time. And I suppose in business, you can still make business deals, but you can still be nice about it and be courteous. And I think if people were more pleasant to other people, if people gave way in traffic, if people let people in on the lift, if people were a lot more courteous to each other, then the world would be so much a better place to be living in. So that would be one of the things that I would certainly advocate, just being nice. Mm. The ways to communicate with me is probably easiest on Twitter, at Dr. Brad McKay. I'm usually on there every few hours, so you can certainly find me easily there. I've also got a Facebook page as well under my name too, Dr. Brad McKay.
Dr. Brad, I'd like to thank you for all the good that you're doing in the world, all the patients that you're healing, and all the inspiration that you're creating. Keep doing what you're doing, and thank you.
Well, thank you very much for having me on. Hopefully everybody else can make similar changes and improve the world one person at a time.
If you've loved this episode, please head over to iTunes and leave us a review. It will mean the world to me, and you'll be spreading the message of Believe. I'm Sam Barry, and I've enjoyed spending this time with you today. Please send me an email, sam@sambarry.com, and let me know what your challenges are. Let me know how I can help you achieve greatness in your life. Everything that we spoke about in today's episode will be in the show notes over at sambarry.com/5. Thank you for spending some time with me today. Don't forget to subscribe and believe.